Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming to this late afternoon session. I know it's been a busy day and already started yesterday, and bless you. And we'll have one more spot after this, so definitely a long day. So thanks for coming. My name is Christoph Feisinger. I'm based in sunny Redmond. If there was a little rain yesterday, I think if there was rain in Brisbane, blame me for bringing some fresh Seattle rain. And today, along with Angus Florence, who's based here in Australia, who's a customer success manager, we're going to talk about, we're going to give you an overview of enterprise social for Microsoft. And I should have said, based in Redmond, and I'm on the SharePoint marketing team. The agenda for this session is hopefully we'll make it a little interactive, but because it's tech ed, and a lot of you, I'm guessing, are IT pro, and some of you might be developers as well. We'll talk specifically, we'll start with, you know, what's our approach with enterprise social, and more importantly, something you care about, you know, what is our roadmap? We did make an acquisition over 13 months ago of a company called Yammer, and, you know, what are we doing about to bring all this together? And at the tail end of the set of slides, I'll talk about this topic. I'll give you a little demo, specifically how's the integration coming together, not the functionality, not how to use Yammer itself. And that's going to lead into the next topic that Angus is going to talk about, again, being an expert on the product, being a customer success manager, helping customers realize value. He'll talk about how this is, you know, this is a journey. It's not just about the technology, which I'll cover. And he'll give you kind of a Yammer 101 crash course. And then more importantly, he'll talk about that methodology that that the Yammer team has built over the years with, you know, number of customers to roll out enterprise social at your company. And I will wrap up with next steps. You'll see there's a lot of links, a lot of information, and we only have 75 minutes, so we're going to try to cram as much as possible, but there'll be plenty of other things you can read on when you get back to your respective desk after this event. Again, we'll try to take questions, but like I mentioned, we do have a few slides and we get demos, so it might take one or two depending on how we're doing with timing. And if not, we'll just save the questions for the end, and then we'll just hang around if there's any things that we haven't answered that you want to get an answer on. So before I start, actually, I should have asked, how many of you were at the keynote yesterday? I should have asked the opposite. How many of you missed the keynote yesterday? Two people. Great. That's pretty good. So anyway, the reason I'm asking is for 95% of you, yesterday Adam Pisoni talked about Yammer and this notion of disruptions and responsive org. So I'm not going to speak too much about it. Again, like I say, there's numerous decks, numerous links at the end of this session that talks about the value, which is typically a question I get quite a bit, especially when I'm talking to CIOs or executives, which is, hey, Christoph, this enterprise social thing, is it just Facebook for the enterprise? And if so, you know, is that really going to help our employees, our customers, our partners be more productive? Is it really going to produce at the end of the day a good return on investment, or is it just another distraction that I'm going to get my employees confused and non-productive? So again, I wasn't planning to talk about the value of enterprise social, but at the very least, I wanted to play a video that kind of illustrate what is the value for some of the customers. And I've got to say, I've been traveling worldwide for the past year and talking about this topic. And you guys in Australia are actually a very mature country on this topic. I don't know if it's a culture. I still wish I could export that model. But you do have a lot of big customers, whether it's, actually I shouldn't say it's not big, but you get customers in retail, in mining, in consulting, in banking, pretty much in all sectors that are pretty far ahead in this notion of leveraging an enterprise social network at their organizations to get benefit.
That's because of me, mainly.
That's because of you?
Yeah, mainly.
That's
a
good look. You're special, so we need to clone you worldwide. So anyway, again, just to show you what is the value, what is Yammer brings in terms of value, I'll just play one video. And again, for the two gentlemen that missed the keynote, Adam talked about some of those case studies. And by the way, it's recorded and the recording is live. It's up on TechNet. I'll look for the keynote and I'll see you that 20-minute segment. And I didn't want to be redundant, so I'm just going to play a first video. Oops. Just get out of full screen mode. Audio?
Audio guy.
Sorry?
Can you turn this down?
Please.
Design and constructor. We are a fully integrated shopping center developer, design and constructor, and shopping center.
Oops. Hang on.
Owner. As a director, I oversee 40 shopping centres across the country. Retail is a very dynamic environment, changing very rapidly. The ability of the team to be able to stay on top of and understand what's coming at them and get an earlier insight into that, I think actually gives us a unique opportunity to be able to work very closely with our retailers so that they understand that we see what's coming and what can we do to support them to be successful. We had a gift card initiative where we were rolling out some changes to the gift card. I think it's fair to say that some of the changes were perhaps not as well thought through as they could have been, and the team on the ground was seeing that real time in feedback coming back from retailers and feedback coming back from shoppers. What Yammer allowed us to do was identify that issue very, very quickly and quickly collaborate on a solution. The solution that was delivered certainly saved at least 6, if not more, weeks of headache. Yammer for me allows me to engage in a much deeper way. I get involved in conversations now with people who may be concierge staff members, security team members, people who I would only occasionally see when I'm actually physically out in the centre, and frankly most of those conversations would be, hi, how are things? Versus a Yammer conversation can be much more precise about a specific topic or a specific event. Social networking is so important in business right now because so many people are using it in their private lives. It's become very much the norm. It puts the power in the hands of the employees and allows them to define how and when they want to communicate, as well as how and when they want to receive that communication.
I should have asked, how many of you are using Yammer today in your organizations? Quite a bit. How many of you are Office 365 customers? A little bit. I'm assuming the rest SharePoint on-prem? Good. So anyway, I picked this one, obviously, local retailer. But typically, just to recap what was discussed in the video, is typically the value of enterprise social typically is categorized into around three verbs. It helps engagement. So exactly like you've seen in the video or like Adam talked yesterday, we want to tap the full potential of our employees. And in retail or in the food industry or in mining, whatever, it doesn't matter. But you know you get a lot of employees or in manufacturing, they're actually not sitting in front of a PC. There might be security or they might be waiters. They might be operating heavy equipment, but those are still part of your organizations. And guess what? If you're having a big security campaign and you wanna, or safety campaign and you wanna improve safety at your organizations, how do you reach to those operators that are not in front of a PC? If you're a retailer, you know, how do you make sure that even the security person is bought into whatever initiatives you're driving? If you're in the food industry and you're launching a new burger, like Adam discussed yesterday, how do you make sure you capture feedback from the waiters and waitress, which again are not sitting in front of a PC? So I think it's a very interesting topic that with enterprise social, it's not just about the folks in front of their desk, but potentially what we call non-information workers that potentially might not even have an email address, but again, still, they're still your employees, and they might have very, very valuable feedback depending on whatever initiative you're doing, whether it's ideations or just improving health or safety records at your organization. So that's just one example. And again, like I said, there's plenty of others in the Australian market across multiple segments. So switching gears, and specifically what I talked about earlier, which is what is our roadmap? And I'll start with, you know, what is unique about us at Microsoft? And the way we talk about it is, you know, I should have said enterprise social is not just about Yammer. It's not just about hashtag and that mention. Things we're probably used to in Facebook or different Instagram, Twitter, and things like that. But it goes beyond that. You could argue that this is social, right? You're in a room, you travel, you took a couple days off work, whether you travel from Melbourne or Sydney or Victoria or whatever, and that's social, face-to-face, right? Be on the phone, that's social. And Yammer is just another form, and I'll talk about it later. But the idea is there's different tools and communication channels to get things done. And so what's unique about Microsoft is the first thing, we think social should be seamless. And what we say by that, what we mean by that is, if Christoph is in PowerPoint and maybe he's producing a deck for our tech ed presentation with Angus, and he leaves and breathes in PowerPoint because that's the tool I'm using to get that deliverable out of the door, I should be able in the future to potentially start a conversation. Yes, I can use the rich PowerPoint co-authoring and revisions, but maybe I want to start a conversation, say, hey, Angus, here's the first version of the deck, insert your slides, what do you think, you know, timing, et cetera, et cetera. So the point is seamless, it should social, I shouldn't have to go to another tool to loop in whatever the team members that I want to get feedback or input or announce, hey, I've got this V1 of this picture for a marketing campaign, or here's the new employee charter that we're going to give to all the new hires. I should be able to do that with whatever tool I have that I'm using at this moment in time. And you'll see, I'll give you a little more color about that. So first of all, it should be seamless, not a destination. The second thing is, we think social should be, enterprise social should be contextual. And what we mean by that is, we all in our life, whether we're in IT, probably a lot of you, or whether you work for the project management office, or whether you work in R&D, or you're in finance, or HR, or in consulting, you all have a set of processes that we follow. You know, how do you engage with an employee, or how do you roll out an update on a server? Or again, if you're in manufacturing, you probably have a lot of processes around safety and how do you do downtime on maintenance on specific equipment. So we think that social should be contextual, meaning potentially all our lives in the business world are driven by business process, and at different stages, different steps in that process, maybe I need to have a conversation with my peers, or maybe I need to have an announcement, or maybe I need to loop in experts, or maybe I don't even know the experts, but I'm going to ask a question to the community. Hey, I'm working on this piece of equipment, but I need help on repairing whatever is broken. So let me reach out. So again, it should be contextual, meaning it should not just appear randomly. I should be able to have the conversation that are related to a business process. And then the third thing around our approach with enterprise social is it should be trusted. You know, whether it's Westfield or any of the customers that Adam talked about yesterday, like Nationwide, which is large insurance, or the Red Robin, which is a fast food burger chain in the US, you're going to be capturing valuable intellectual property. Maybe it's a new recipe for a burger, or maybe it's, information about your competitors. Maybe it's financial information. So you want all that information to be trusted, secure, governed. You know, this is not a public enterprise social network that we've all used to that potentially we can be tapping into and selling ads. No, this needs to be controlled and abide to whatever regulatory or compliance that your organization has, depending on the department or depending on the industry. So that's what's unique about our approach with enterprise social. The next couple slides is, again, like I said, you know, I've talked about a little bit about the value. The next couple slides are just three scenarios on how to enable social value at your enterprise. And the first one is typically, actually I'm going too fast. I'll talk about the three scenarios next. But remember I told you that enterprise social should be seamless? And this is a little bit of a double click on that. And our approach is, like I say, it shouldn't be a destination, meaning social, if I want to be in social and let's say Yammer all day, that's fine. But if I want to live and breathe into whatever tool of choice, I used PowerPoint earlier, but it could be another productivity tool, I should be able to do so. So our vision is that you should have a single layer that connects all those applications. So obviously, we're going to be best citizen with our stack at Microsoft. And I'll talk again about the roadmap later on, but we're going to start with Office 365. And what I mean by Office 365 is the whole suite of services. Is it Exchange? Is it Link? Is it SharePoint? Et cetera, et cetera. Obviously, SharePoint, think of this as maybe SharePoint on-premises. Link, you know, we think there's, again, dotted lines as well in the future where potentially if I want to be social on Link and maybe see a Yammer conversation, I should be able to do so without leaving that tool of choice that I'm using, let's say, Link client on that PC or Link mobile on my phone. And then we're also going to integrate with our Dynamics suite, things of Microsoft Dynamics as, you know, a CRM and other products that Dynamics division offers. And then the last one is kind of a catch-all for all the line of business apps that we have. And I know, you know, especially in IT or any organization, including us at Microsoft, we've got dozens. Whether it's homegrown apps, like, I don't know, ticketing, call centers, whether it's, you know, ERP, enterprise resource planning, whether it's your accounting, your HR systems, et cetera, et cetera. So we think, you know, what's unique, back to the slides before, that Yammer can connect all those apps. And another point typically I make to a technical audience is, it doesn't matter if those apps are on-premises or hosted or, you know, software as a services or infrastructure as a service. You know, Yammer obviously is an online service, but the beauty is to connect all those things. So if you got, like, a, let's say, a SharePoint form on-premises, a very common scenario, but maybe you got, you know, a CRM online application, we think potentially Yammer could be the glue between all those line of business apps that every organization has. And again, the tagline social should be woven in. Depending on the role and your usage, you shouldn't have to go to another app to see conversations and to participate or get help from the community that you belong to. So with that, like I said, let's switch into three, think of how-to scenarios to enable enterprise social at your company. And the first one we talk about is social productivity platform. And remember what I told you earlier, that depending on, you know, we all do that, we, depending on the time of the day and depending on what we're trying to do or what projects we're in, we might use different set of tools. So here where you're looking at, for instance, SharePoint, the new SharePoint 2013 SkyDrive Pro, and you know, this is my documents in the cloud, synced to how many devices I've got. It's nice, secure, and safe. So, you know, that's what I use every day at Microsoft, so I don't have to worry about my PC being stolen. And you know, maybe Glove has a document that's stored in SkyDrive Pro. And you know, you can get the overcard that we've delivered with 2013, that's the Office web apps. I can get a preview of the document. But what's interesting is Garth, potentially, can start a conversation with his peers. You know, is it a conversation because he wants to loop in Angus, say, hey, here's a V1 on my deck, or here's a draft of this deliverables or specifications, let's say we're in R&D. You know, Angus, take a look. Or maybe it's an announcement. Hey, you know, team, marketing team, R&D team, IT team, you know, here's the best practice to update, to upgrade to Windows 8.1 RTM. So I can easily post. So Garv didn't have to go elsewhere, but pretty quickly, he can start a conversation in Yammer without leaving the tool of choice. Again, I'll show you later, but you just click. It's a little hard to see. Let's see if I get the laser pointer. I'm not gonna try it, but there's a little post in the middle. So Garv doesn't have to leave his tool of choice, but yet he can start a conversation. I'm using PowerPoint. Actually, this is PowerPoint, but earlier was Word. And I'm not saying you shouldn't be using the rich co-offering revisions that Office offers. I'm just saying that adding a layer of conversation potentially can get you things out of the door faster. Maybe you can help your peers discover content that has been produced. So here you're seeing this is a mock-up. You know, we haven't shipped that, but this is a web app, so rendering in the browser. In this case, of a PowerPoint slide, and you can see that persistent discussion from the peers on whatever the discussion was around this deliverable. And then, you know, this continues depending, so I can have persistent conversation around that deck, but maybe, you know, I need urgent feedback, and then maybe I can see presence from my peers, and then that's when I would switch to link and link online. And, you know, this can go a step further. I think there's a demo tomorrow where maybe, you know, here it shows Molly, one of those fictitious characters, but maybe I'm working with a graphic designer, a freelance DBA, database administrator, and that person maybe doesn't have a link because they're just a one-man shop. Maybe they're on Skype. So, you know, link on Skype, I can do that federation, and I can get things done. Maybe I can schedule a call with those different peers that participate in this deliverable, and I can get things done. So, in summary, what we mean by social productivity is, again, we're going to weave in that notion of social in pretty much all the tools that we have in the Office division. And like I just discussed earlier, and then as I just showed you, social is not just Yammer conversation, but potentially, depending on the communication mode that I need, on the urgency of the answers, I might switch to something a little more immediate, like such as Link IM or Link Voice on Video, to get things done. So that's one example of a how-to scenario to enable enterprise social. The second scenario is what we call a social intranet. Actually, I shouldn't say we call. There's a lot of buzz on if you just do a Bing search on it. You'll see a lot of articles about this. But the notion is, you know, we all have intranets for many years, and you know, hopefully a lot of you are using SharePoint. And the realizations is employees, maybe some that are sitting at their desk, maybe are going to that portal, but over time, they're not, you know, it's not vibrant, it's not exciting. And people are not engaging on content, meaning maybe you're releasing something and maybe you're going to get feedback. Or maybe you're going to call out for the employees, hey, where should we have the Christmas party next December? Or hey, we're going to do a contest and we're going to give away a free Xbox for whoever has the best safety record improvement in my manufacturing plant. So what you're looking at is just a mock-up of a rich intranet that you can build with SharePoint 2013. You know, obviously, we got rich editing capabilities in SharePoint 2013, as well as, yes, you can put rich content such as video and stuff like that. But what you're looking at in the middle is that notion of adding a dynamic conversation within that site, which is, again, what we call social intranet. And like I showed earlier, yes, you know, besides engaging with your different peers using that notion of that water cooler that, you know, is maybe the company feed, you can also switch to something more real-time, which is link integration, where potentially I want to have an immediate conversation with that person because I think they've got a great idea or I want to help them right away. And I should be able to do that in the future thanks to link integration. And as you would ever expect, mobile is definitely key, and meaning that when, you know, this is maybe the first big screenshot is what I'm looking at on my PC, but as soon as I'm traveling, let's say I'm going to another site, I'm visiting customers, or I'm just had to leave home earlier to pick up the kids, I should be able to continue those conversations, or at least see what's happening in the company on my favorite mobile device. Obviously, this is a Windows phone. Sounds funny now that we've announced the Nokia acquisition. But yes, there's apps on Android, on iOS, and we care, yes, you know, this is not just about phone. I could have put screenshots of iPad and Windows 8 tablets as well. The third scenario to enable enterprise social is to bring social to business processes. I remember when I was telling you our approach, you know, it's about being contextual and seamless, and I was talking about that a little bit. And the idea here is, again, think of your organizations, folks in finance or HR, or it doesn't matter, or in supply chain, they're not in front of SharePoint every day. They might be in their favorite SAP or their favorite ERP, and they're in accounting, they're doing their double ledger all day, and that's fine. You know, if that's the tool that they need to get their job done, they shouldn't have to leave that tool. But yet, if they want to loop in experts to help them, I don't know, close the fiscal, close the quarter, or just get a sales opportunity out of the door, we should be able to do in context from that line of business app that they use every day. So what you're looking at here is some of the integration that we shipped in February of this year, where, you know, there's two sides to the coin. There's maybe Christoph, or I'll say Angus, the CEO of Contoso, and he's the executive. And he wants to see what's happening. And you know, he's not going to go into, let's say, a CRM tool or a sales automation tool to see every opportunity. But yet, as a CEO, maybe he wants to be notified. Hey, we won a $1 million deal in Queensland or New South Wales. Or we've lost a $1 million opportunity. So he cares, you know, at a high level on those big wins and losses. And maybe his view of the world is Yammer. And that's what it's a little hard to see. But you can see in the center, it's an activity that has been generated by another system. So the activity didn't initiate in Yammer. But again, Angus, because he's the executive, he's the boss, he wants to see that activity. And let's say Christoph, his peers, who let's say head of sales for New South Wales, he's living and breathing, in this case, in the sales automation tool. But again, maybe he wants to loop in Angus to get, you know, his help. Maybe I need him to visit the customer to take that opportunity from, let's say, 80% to 100% one deal. So what you're looking at is actually our dynamic CRM online offering, where, again, I can leave and breathe in that sales automation tool, but yet I can loop in peers, whatever I need to do to bring that opportunity to the finish line. I'm using, the example here is around sales automation and CRM, but you can, you know, think of adding social to your ticketing, to your maintenance system, to your ERP, to your HR systems, and I'm sure you have a thousand other examples in your head of all the line of business apps that you have your colleagues using day in, day out. So that's what we mean by social business process. Potentially, you can generate a significant innovations, and you know, in the end, it's going to yield business agility by bringing this social layer to existing app and connecting all the peers in your organization. You know, maybe breaking down the silos between that sales team that using a CRM tool that's not plugged into the rest of your organization, by just putting in that social layer that will connect that CRM, or it's online or on-prem, with, let's say, the rest of the organizations that may be in front of a PC or maybe using Yammer to see what's happening. So I just talked about the three ha scenarios. Just to make it a little more fun, let's switch to a demo. And I'll show you some of the innovations that we delivered. Let me log back in again. I can remember my password. So what I'm going to show you, this is a 365 tenant. You know, you can sign up for one free of charge. It's a trial tenant, and you can kick the tires. And what I'm going to show you is specifically some of the integration that we started doing between that Yammer as a social layer and some of the Office 365 stack. What I just logged into is what we call the tenant administrator, tenant admin. So you know, you only see that if you, again, an administrator of the tenant. If you're on premises, that's you know, all the admin that has access to, let's say, the central admin in SharePoint. So I'm not going to go over all those services, but specifically, I'm going to go into SharePoint, and you got all the different menus. You can administer, exchange, link, and all those good things. And if I go to the SharePoint admin, there's a new, if you go to settings, which is the last option, and I'm going to click settings. And what I want to bring your attention to is there's this new button, Enterprise Social Collaboration, use Yammer services. So that's something that we delivered end of May, which is kind of an on-on switch. By default, it's SharePoint is selected. And by using Yammer, which is a recommendation, suddenly you see what happens downstream. But basically, again, remember what I told you? It shouldn't be a destination. And then at the end of the day, you should only have one social network powering your enterprise. So it shouldn't be, it should be one or the other. It shouldn't be both. Like, you know, you hopefully only have one company email. You don't have two. And same thing with social. You should only have one newsfeed to care about, and you shouldn't have two. So our recommendations, our big bet is Yammer. So I've switched that. You can try that again on your on a trial tenant if you want. It takes about 15 minutes. And then what it does is it's going to replace what we call the suite navigation. So this button, if it was by default, it says newsfeed. And when, as soon as I switch that, again, after a couple minutes, it'll replace that link to Yammer. And again, I can click on that, and yes, it's going to launch Yammer. I'll talk about what we're going to do in the future around tighter integration. So that's to enable Yammer as your to power your social experience in your Office 365 tenant. The next thing we did is, okay, great. So that's one step. But the next thing typically you want is to bring those conversations to those different assets that you have in SharePoint. I remember when I was telling you a social intranet is one of the scenarios to enable enterprise social at your organization. And this is, again, a mock-up from our demo tenant where we got a fictitious Contoso homepage. And what I did here is I've added the Yammer app in this homepage. So potentially, again, this is a demo network, so there's not a lot of activities, but I can see all that activity happening in the different folks I'm following and also in the old company feed at my organization. So potentially I can have some serendipity and some discovery of some of the folks I'm following and things that, that they might be doing that might be of interest to me. And I can participate in discussions, you know, hello, tech ed. So what this is basically an app that's free of charge. And you can do that. And basically, you go add an app. So you click on the settings. And in SharePoint, you get the list. You can grab applications from your company. So I'm just going to go to the SharePoint store, which is the ad side, and just to show you where the app is. So the app is free of charge and available. You can already get a peek of the richness of all the application ecosystem that's available for SharePoint. I can type. I'm just going to search for Yammer. And you can see the first one is called the Yammer app for SharePoint. And pretty much like you have in, when you're purchasing an app or as a consumer or as an enterprise, it gives you a description, some couple screenshots of what it does. And you just need to add this app. I've already added it. And then to get into that homepage, let me go back here. I just need to edit the page, add the app, and voila. That's how I did it on this intranet. And then the other scenario is that I put in here is, again, typically either you want to bring a real-time conversation to your social intranet, but at the end of the day, you're hopefully, by bringing social, you're going to get something done faster. You know, it's going to help you with your day-to-day task. In this case, I'm not going to work through the entire demo, but the idea is we got a marketing campaign, I'm going to be launching a product, and I've added to this site, where I've got all the marketing material to launch that marketing campaign with a specific product. In this case, the Yammer app, instead of mapping to all the people that I follow or the entire company activities, it's only mapped to a specific group called a marketing group. So again, when I log in, let's say that's my homepage because I'm in marketing, I can see all the activities, all the discussions that are happening between the marketing org at Contoso with one click. And then I can, you know, click on the app. And if I want a more immersive experience, I'm taken to the Yammer group, and now I can see all the same conversations that I was seeing earlier in SharePoint. So, but wait, there's more. So that's the app. The third thing I want to show you, and then I'm going to switch to slides, is, again, if you remember that screenshot, you know, we think Yammer and SharePoint is definitely a great better together. You know, SharePoint's been around for over a decade and it's got definitely industrial strength content management, whether it's, you know, having very complicated workflow to manage whatever the lifecycle of documents you're producing or things like SkyDrive. And like I say, you've got a lot of existing documents in those document library, but maybe you want to collaborate in context because, as I say, it should be seamless. And here, so I went to a list of documents specific to that site. So this is just a standard document library, and in 2013 you get a nice preview over card on those documents, really helping me, you know, is this the document that I care about? So it's looks like it's a little slow. We'll blame it on the internet connection. But basically there's a new button right here. You see post. And as soon as I do that, it gives me the ability. I can say, Angus, please review V1 of marketing campaign. And I can notify others, and maybe I'll put that into the marketing team. Okay, we'll put it in the IT support. And voila. So one click, I didn't leave SharePoint. I'm where probably maybe I'm living and breathing, working on those different documents. And I started a conversation with peers that, in this case, I asked for my peer to do a review cycle, but it could have been an announcement. Hey, here's the new marketing campaign plan, you'll pass it around. So the idea is I didn't need, you know, it's in context. I didn't need to leave that SharePoint to start collaborating with my peers on a specific deliverable. And that works for all the items that are stored in the document library. Obviously, this is Office document, but I could have done the same thing, initiate a conversation on a JPEG, on whatever file you put in your document library. So stay tuned. We're going to make the official announcement in a couple weeks. But this is just, again, a glimpse of some of the tighter integration between Yammer on SharePoint. So switching gears, again, I'll show you a glimpse on some of the initial integration, but we're not going to stop there. And that's what I have on this slide. Typically, when I talk about a roadmap, because this is a top-of-mind topic, what I remind everyone is things are going to be different going forward ever since, you know, we've launched 365 and the new wave of SharePoint, Exchange, Link, and SharePoint, et cetera. And basically, our new development methodology is going to be very rapid. Yammer ships new features on a weekly basis. In 365, as my colleague Michael Atala discussed yesterday, it's on a monthly basis. And the point is, things are going to move very fast. No longer, you know, you need to wait 3 years to see significant innovation. It might not, you know, at that cadence, it's not going to be a big bang every time. It's going to be incremental. And more importantly, all the innovations is going to be based on feedback, meaning we're not going to do it in a vacuum. Back in Redmond, hey, let's pretend where we think what your need is going to be in 3 years. We're going to test that based on data. Hey, here's what's working, what's not working, based on analytics that we get back from usage. We're going to tweak things. Maybe you want to go back to the drawing board and tell the engineers, hey, we don't think that feature is really helping engagement. So, you know, go back to the drawing board because I don't think it's ready for prime time. So we got a very new way of engineering products, and that's what translates into this roadmap. So today I've talked already about that switch to enable Yammer as your default social experience in 365. I talk about the app. One thing I forgot to mention is we also publish guidance for on-premises. I've got a slide about SharePoint on-prem later. But again, the idea of having, you should only have one news feed, you know, you can enable that on-premises as well, and that's a white paper. And then in our last roadmap update, which was to mark the 1 year anniversary on June 25th, we announced some of the things we're working on in the fall and in the winter timeframe. And a lot of people ask me, you know, hey, Christoph, how can you not giving me what you're going to do next year, next 2 years? And the reason is, again, back to the first bullet, we're going to iterate incrementally. And while we do have a laundry list of things on our backlog in terms of tighter integration, that's what's been committed in terms of engineering resources to date. So I know those are going to ship. Everything else is on the backlog. So again, you can read that. You know, I've talked about document conversations. Office 365 single sign-on, we've documented that. But there's a lot more things that are going to be coming. And it's definitely going to be the next six months are you're going to see a lot of innovations coming. Bring the products together or just pure net new innovations on the services. And then the next question I get is, okay, Christoph, what's happening after the winter? Well, we're going to continue to iterate. And again, back to what I was talking earlier, you know, our aspiration is to deliver connected experiences. And that's what I was talking earlier when I was talking about social productivity or when I was saying social should be in context, is that we're going to continue to integrate with the Microsoft stack. You know, I mentioned Link earlier. Those are aspirations. But maybe in the future, you shouldn't have, if you're using Link, or if you're using Yammer and you want to switch to voice and video because you're old-fashioned and you think maybe that's a better way to get settled things, whatever is the issue, or you want some provide some immediate help to your peer, you should be able to do so. So that's where we're striving in the future. And again, this is going to be ongoing, so stay tuned for more announcement. With that, and one more slide. Sorry, Angus. We'll get a buffer. How about on-premises? So we do care about on-premises business. I didn't ask specifically or show hands on which version of SharePoint. But you know, let's be very clear. First of all, you can integrate Yammer today with SharePoint 2010 or SharePoint 2007. And for 2013, you can do so as well. And that's actually our recommended approach. I don't know, some of you might still be in a decision process. You might be on SharePoint 2010, or you might be embarking on a prototype or proof of concept or an upgrade to 2013. Again, our recommendation is Yammer should power your social experience. And those two reasons down there. You know, it's immediate, you know, it's instant on, and it's also the service that's going to be innovating the faster. And to enable that on-premises, those two links that, you know, you can download the slides, there's that guidance, that white paper I talked about, and then there's that app that I showed it to you online, but guess what, in 2013, the online app works also for SharePoint on-premises. So that's our recommended approach where, you know, another way to think about it is think hybrid. Social in the cloud, SharePoint 2013 on-premises. And then If you cannot go to the cloud for regulatory or whatever reasons you have, then our recommendation is to go to SharePoint 2013. SharePoint 2013 has great social capabilities, you know, newsfeed, photos, which I didn't show you. And again, you know, that should be the for those of you that cannot leverage a multi-tenant service. Okay, so just to summarize that, I talk about the roadmap, I talk about our approach. Now, Angus is gonna switch more on how to get started with Yammer, and then I'll transition to that cookbook called The Social Journey.
Cool, how do we switch back to this?
Taking up site, number 7. Here we go.
All right, cool. So what I want to show you guys today is basically just the 101 to help you get value from Yammer really quickly. Again, it's a question in the customer success team that I'm part of. It's a question we get all the time. So how do I get value from Yammer? What does it mean? What's the ROI? We get that question a lot as well. So what I want to show is how you can make Yammer make sense to you, and then you can go and explain this to the other guys in your company really quickly just by doing a really few simple tips that I'll take you through today. So for those who haven't seen Yammer before, this is the homepage that you get when you go to yammer.com. And the main features on here are obviously the newsfeed, which is this bit down the middle, and this is the guts of it, and this is what I'm going to tell you how to customize this to suit you and make sense to you. We've got the groups down the side, which again, Christoph was talking about, and how we can link those into different applications. The newsfeed on the right-hand side here, and this is the activity stream. And this is really for when you, right now it just shows Yammer activity, but as you start to build this into your other applications, it could be Angus updated an opportunity in Dynamics, or Angus created a purchase order in SAP. So this is the activity stream that starts to show a lot of those activities from different apps. And then across the top, we've got your navigation and profile stuff. So I'll talk about those really quickly. But what I want to go through today is really building this My Feed to help it make sense to you. So, and this can work with both. So if you've got an existing Yammer tenant and it's quite a mature network, you've had it for a few years, a lot of the comments that we get when we go into customers like that is saying, it's too noisy, it doesn't make any sense, I can't find anything I want to find in there. Or it could be, if you're a brand new customer, how do I make sense of this where people are just sharing links to news articles? How do I get it to actually bring value to me? So what the premise that we want to try and convince people of is, when you first start a Yammer network, Yammer's very much a place you come to talk about work. So you'll post stuff that you think might be interesting for other people, that kind of thing. What we really want you to do, and what we do at Yammer is actually use Yammer as a place to do work. And whether that's embedded in a different application or using yammer.com, it's really getting there and doing your work inside there. And to be able to do that, you need to be able to find value really quickly. So more for people who have had mature networks and have lots of groups and lots of people and thousands of messages. What I want to do is just reset expectations, and sometimes, and I even do it at Microsoft. When October last year, when we moved into the Microsoft Yammer network, there was 400 of us at Yammer, and then we just joined a network with over 100,000 people in it. And my background before joining Yammer was I was a SharePoint consultant. So I joined this group, and I saw the SharePoint group, and I thought, that's cool, I'll join that group, and I'll join the Xbox group. And it was just before Windows 8 was going to be launched, so I joined the Windows 8 group. And I joined all these amazing groups, and I could talk to all these cool people around the world. But all of a sudden, someone who uses Yammer every day to get their work done, all of a sudden my newsfeed was just cluttered with all this stuff that didn't actually help me do my job. So what I do, I have this very simple rule that I tell new customers or existing customers and a lot of the Microsoft guys is the 5x5. So follow 5 groups, join 5 groups and follow 5 people. Keep it really simple. But they've got to be 5 groups that you do work with every day. So it could be projects you're a part of, your team group, your area, and it must be 5 people you work with every day. So the simplest way to join groups is up the top here. You have your groups menu, and you can see a list of all the groups within your company. And again, there might be groups on there that are cool and you want to experiment more with it. But again, I encourage you just to join the groups that interest you and you work on a daily basis. And then this way it will, it narrows that my feed down and cuts out all the noise. So if I join my project group, so I've got, you know, I work on the NAB account, so I'm in the NAB account group. I've got Telstra, I've got my local Yammer team. I've got my global Yammer team I'm a part of, and that's really about it. We keep it very small. So I know that any post that comes into my feed it's usually something that I'm already working on. So it adds value for me, and I can add value back into it. Same goes with people. When you start Yammer, there's always people in your organization who love Yammer and are very social and love to share lots of stuff, and they might put in pictures and jokes and that kind of stuff, and that might be cool. But if they're not someone who you work with every single day, chances are they're not going to be adding a huge amount of value for you in your Yammer, in your feed. So again, come into the people section and just add your colleagues, your peers, your manager, maybe your team, and maybe if you need to follow some execs, you can do that too. But really keep it small. And the beauty of that is when you come back into your My Feed, this will now only show you the stuff that you need to see every day, and you can get that value really, really quickly. Now, the last thing I do when I join these groups is you have these three different options at the top here. So you've got top, all, and following. So following is exactly what it sounds like. It's basically all the messages from the groups you're a part of and all the messages from the people you follow. So that's why I'm saying it's important to only have 5 and 5 to begin with. And this is what I use, particularly in Microsoft. There's 180,000 people on that network. I only really need to see the people that I work with on a daily basis. The next one is all. And again, for new networks, this might be a good option because you get a chance to see what's happening. You can connect different people if they're not quite sure what they're doing. All basically shows every single message in every public group across the network by anybody. So again, in a network like ours, it doesn't work. But for smaller ones, or if you're just starting, it's not a bad way to start. And then the final one is top. And this is a mix between following, so it's just your following group, but it also, if I don't follow Christoph, but he happens to post in a public group and he gets 100 replies, it's an interesting conversation, Yammer will pick that up and put it into my feed because it thinks it might be something I'm interested in. So I personally just use the following one, and then you can save that preference with the little cog and say, remember my feed selection. And from now on, that's my default feed. And this is my default feed on all my devices now. So if it's on my mobile, it's on my tablet, it's in my desktop app if I use it, it's everywhere. So if it's if you're embedded in SharePoint or Dynamics, wherever it is, it's that same feed everywhere you go. So it's really useful to get that right up front. How are we tracking for time? Okay. So the next thing I want to show you very quickly is how to set up your notifications properly. So one of the things that we often tell people who use Yammer or any sort of social network is it will hopefully reduce the amount of email that you get on a daily basis. And it does do that the majority of time. But when you first join Yammer and when you invite people to Yammer, they get inundated with emails. Every time someone clicks on something, you tend to get an email. So I always encourage people to come in and set up their notifications properly. So I just went into account, edit account, and you can do a whole bunch of stuff in here. But today I just want to focus on notifications. And in here, this is all your notifications for your network. And this is what you get by default. So again, the daily digest. So if you follow that rule that I said and you just follow the groups and people that are interesting to you, your daily digest becomes a lot more relevant. So you get an email and it has stuff that you care about. That's really important. Maybe to start off, you can do daily, switch it to weekly. I personally don't get any emails from Yammer, so I turn this off because I'm in there all the time. But again, depending on your maturity, go with that. The next sections is really around notifications. And this is where I don't believe you necessarily get the value that you need. If you're going to get email from Yammer, or if you're going to get email from anybody for that matter, you want to make sure that it's actually useful to you and you can action it and get something from it. So almost all the options here you can get from the notification bell inside Yammer, or if you've got it on your apps, you'll get a buzz on your phone. So you can actually get these ambient notifications in other places. And again, the fact that someone likes a message that I post doesn't necessarily add value to what I'm doing. So I generally untick all those notifications. But the interesting thing is this next part. So these are the groups that I'm a member of. So again, if you go back to what I said at the start, and you're only a member of the groups that you need to be a part of, this actually becomes really useful. So if I'm in the finance team, and I need to be aware of everything that is going on in that group, I can tick this, and I'll actually get an email every time someone posts into that group. And that's useful, particularly for people who are in that transition of going from email into social. So they'll get an email in Outlook, and they can either click on the link and go into Yammer and respond, or they can respond straight from that email, and it'll get posted into Yammer and keep them in that conversation. So this is a really cool way. So this way, you almost guarantee that any email you get from Yammer is actually relevant to you and is going to help you do your job. Okay. And then the final thing I just wanted to touch on really is around groups and how you use groups within Yammer. So this is not the free version, is it? Okay. So to create a group in Yammer is really easy, and anyone on your network can do it. It's not an admin thing. It's anyone on a network can create one. It's as simple as saying create group. You give it a name, a description. You can decide whether it's public or private. So if I say teched.au, give a description. Again, I always encourage people to make groups public if you can. The more stuff that is public and transparent, the quicker and more discoverable this sort of stuff is. Obviously, there are times when you need private groups, but as much as you can, try and keep stuff public. You can add anyone you want, and again, you can also do bulk updates to this. So if you wanted to, if I wanted to add everyone in TechEd to a group, I could do that just using a CSV. Okay, and now you've got your group. So the beauty of a group is you can now, if you're trying to move people from email to Yammer, which is what we do on a daily basis at Microsoft now, is basically, if you think of a DL, so I could create a DL for TechEd.au and everybody in this room to it. And then I could email you out and you could respond back, and very quickly it becomes a nightmare. So what we do instead is we create a group, add everybody to the group, and we can start to have those conversations in here. The problem with that is, though, if we have 2,000 people who are at TechEd posting to this group, all of a sudden you have that same problem with the noise. So if I have an important announcement that this room has changed to room 8 and I post it in here, unless you're looking at that group, you'll never see it. So the beauty of groups and being admins of groups is you have this ability to post announcements. An announcement is like a standard Yammer post, but you're able to give it a title, and then there's some basic formatting, so you can add links and bold stuff that you can't do in a normal Yammer message, and then post that. And what this does as an announcement is actually notifies everybody in that group. So, and they'll get an email if they sign up to that group as well. So it's a good way to transfer. If you're trying to get people onto Yammer, moving them from DLs into Yammer groups is a really great way to start to do that. And the final thing I want to show you quickly before this is around following content. So as Christoph was saying, and I was saying, you can follow people and follow groups, and that starts to build out your social network. What's really cool is you can start to follow content in Yammer, and it's not only in Yammer, but in SharePoint and other apps as well. But a simple example of this is if we upload a file to Yammer. Where did my file go? Anyway, if we uploaded a file to Yammer, I'm not sure where they went, you can basically follow a file.
Put it in TechEd. It was on the old company.
Anyway, is it up here? Anyway, so you can follow content. So basically, the point is, and what Christoph was alluding to before, is if we're working on this presentation, which we actually did in our Microsoft network, he uploaded to a group. I follow that file. Whenever he makes a change to it, I get a ping and notification that I can go and fix it up, and then he gets a ping. And that's really good with the social stuff, but then when, and again, Christoph talked about it, if you start to put that into things like your CRM, so I follow an account, and every time someone makes a change to an opportunity, and I get pinged on that, and then I can rope in other people, that's when you start to get real value, and you can tie those into groups and all kinds of stuff. So that's... when you start to get that social graph of objects and content within your organization, that's when it becomes really powerful. And then when you put search, not only do you find the content you're looking for, the document, but you'll also then find the conversation that goes with it, which is sometimes more important because files can lose their value really quickly, but the conversations that happen around them, that's the stuff that's really cool because you can find out who worked on them, how they got to that point, who made the decisions, and then how you can go and find those new documents and update them. So that's kind of it from a really, really, really quick 101. I had a bit more stuff, but I think we're going to run out of time. What was the other one? Six. So what I want to talk about now quickly is the social journey. And this is something that my team do as the customer engagement team. So we look after, basically once you're a paid customer of Yammer, we come in and help you derive value from Yammer and, you know, run best practice sort of seminars, we can do workshops and training, and basically make sure that you guys are getting the value from Yammer and social. So we developed this methodology called the social journey, which is basically how we get customers and we take them through from the very start, from not having a network and planning for it, right through to rolling it out across the business, getting champions, getting community He manages integrations, all that kind of stuff. So the five main pillars, and again, this is all available publicly online, and I've got a link that I can share with you guys at the end, so you can go through this later. But the five main things are, the first one is really about defining your vision. So the important thing to remember about a social network is it's not a technology implementation. A successful YAML network is not a software that you install. It's actually where you have engaged, you have adoptions of people are on there and people are using it. So if you think of traditional, you know, I used to go and do SharePoint installs, the success was when you got it up and running and you set it as the homepage of everyone's thing. This is the next step. Because it's in the cloud, it's on, there's no installation. You basically, it's really about getting that value and getting that adoption and engagement across the business. The next thing, so to do that, it's really about identifying the vision, not just for Yammer, but for the business. What are the current problems and opportunities you guys have, and how do you think social can fix that? Where have other customers similar to you had success like this, and this is where we can come in and help you do that. And when you think of all the different stuff that you can do with Yammer, it's really then that it comes to the next point about mapping that to business value. So, you know, Yammer itself is not a particularly complex beast. It's fairly simple. It's not feature-rich, but it's how people use Yammer. That's where you get the value from it. It's not actually a, you know, you don't buy Yammer because it has these features. You buy it because it's an open and transparent way of working. Once you've mapped it to the value and you've identified how you're going to use social to uncover and fix some of these problems you've got, it's really about this idea of working social. So if you think, yeah, it's a big change. It's a behavioral change. It's around change management. So people who live in Outlook and live in IM, you know, it's really, really hard. You can't just make them all of a sudden work social. It's a hard thing to do. So it's really about change management and behavior management. And that's sort of where we come in to help you guys guide that. And there's a whole bunch of material on how you can do that as well. So it's really about getting executive engagement, sponsorship, getting them on board and using it, identifying community managers within your business and getting them to help around it, all that kind of stuff. That's sort of the planning phase. The fourth phase is around, you know, driving success, actually doing it, using Yammer as a tool, embedding it in your other systems, getting AD and SSO, all that technical stuff set up and working, and really just going through it. And then the final thing, and again, what Christoph touched on, is everything's iterative. So it's not a set and forget. You don't turn Yammer on, you don't do this once and then walk away. You do that small one, you map to value, you get the success, and then you share that success back to a different part of the business. So you've had HR guys, they're happy they've done their bit. Let's take what we did there and maybe apply it to the sales force, or maybe apply it to the call center guys, or maybe the IT change management. All these different things, and it's just a constant cycle. You've got to keep going through it. It's not something you can just turn on and let it go. There we go for time. I think I'm smashing through it. This is my last slide. Basically, over the sort of 4 or 5 years that Yammer's been around, I've been there for two. Well, we've seen a lot of successes and we've seen a lot of failures too. But these are the four characteristics of a successful Yammer network. And they're pretty easy to do. And again, we've got all the materials that help you do this. But just want to basically take through them. So that clarity of vision, that's the first one. And that's the one I was talking about at the start. It's really about tying it to those business processes and value, business value stuff. If you can't do this, if you can't explain why you're using a social network, it's not because it's free, it's not because you've got a part of your EA. It's got to be tied to something, and you've got to be able to tell people why that. So it's really key that you do that up front. Sponsorship and participation is another really, really good example of how networks have failed and how they've won. So Telstra is a great example. So Telstra had a free Yammer network for about 3 years before they went paid. They had about 6,000 people on there, which is not too bad. Pretty good network, but compared to the size of their organization, it was quite small. In August last year, David Thodey jumped on board Yammer, the CEO, and said, this is really cool. I want my entire exec team on this, and I want them to respond and answer questions that are coming through. So within 4 months, they went from the 6,000 people on there to 25,000 people on there, activated users, and they have hovering between 20 and 23 engaged users, 23,000 engaged users every single month. And that's pretty much because David Thodey's on there every single day, answering questions, responding to posts, and if he can't do it, he's pointing to his other execs around the company to do that as well. So they've had a great example of how sponsorship and participation of that level can really boost your network. But it doesn't have to be executive. We've seen great success in larger companies with general managers, or even having a team leader at a call center can add their entire team to that. And then when they get that success, the next team leader can say, well, look what they've done, and they get their team one. So if you can get that top-down support, it works really well. Because with Yammer, you generally get bottom-up, that's easy. It's the top-down that's the challenge. Integration is the other one. And again, as Christoph said, it's actually going to get easier and easier as we start to integrate more with the products. But even today, you can integrate with all that stuff now, just a little bit harder. And again, Telstra is another great example of how they did this. The day that they integrated Yammer to the homepage of their intranet, their spike went up, I think they were at 10,000 to 15,000 within a week. So that integration and putting it where people are, not making it a separate destination, makes a huge difference. So, you know, if they're in a CRM or they're in an ERP, put Yammer inside that. If they're a sales guy on the road, give them the app, put them on their tablet. You know, they'll be able to get value from it much quicker. And then the final one is community management. And this is this can work. I've seen it work both two different ways. First way is a company has hired a community manager, which is good, but a lot of people won't do that. I mean, it's an extra headcount. But they work really well, and they can connect people, and they do that. What I've seen work really well, though, is every company that has a Yammer network has these evangelists inside it. People love it. And if they don't like Yammer, maybe they're on Twitter or they're on Blogger or Instagram. You'll have people in your organization that get social and know how to get value from working out loud. So you want to empower these guys. And this is actually what we did in the Microsoft network really well. So again, there's people like me and there's 50 of us around the world, and there's no way that's enough to kind of scale to the size that we wanted to get to. So we identified another 100 people inside Microsoft who really understood Yammer and got it and got to work social, and we put them on a training course and we got them certified and we give them access to all the stuff to be able to go and connect other people. And ideally, the end game is that every single person in your organization is a community manager. It shouldn't be down to one person to connect this stuff. The community should manage itself. So really try and find those key people on your network who embrace this stuff and get it and empower them. Don't block them down. Let them do this stuff. Run with it. Train them. Certify them. Get them out there and get them helping other people so you can get more and more champions. Final one. So this is the success center I was talking about. So this is, if you go to success.yammer.com, everything I've spoken about is on there. It's all free, all public. You've got the social journey stuff. There's a whole bunch of templates and resources you can download and rebrand and use in your own networks and your own intranets. There's a bunch of videos and decks for training, webinars, all sorts of stuff. There's product updates for when we're releasing new features. So that's sort of the Yammer roadmap. And then in the admin and IT, again, it's all public, but you can get the SharePoint installation stuff. You can learn how to do AD sync and SSO. There's all sorts of integrations and admin tools in there. And this is getting updated, you know, constantly, weekly, bi-weekly. So lots and lots of stuff in there. Definitely check out success.yammer.com. Yeah, that's it. I'll probably hand back to you now.
Thank you, Angus.
Cheers, mate.
So hopefully you've seen... Sorry, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really interesting one. I mean, I haven't ever seen that particular example, but one thing that a social network does, good or bad, is it will amplify your company's culture. So if you have a bad company culture or you have a bunch of employees that are unhappy with what's happening, you know, if you give them something like this, they have a voice to do that. But I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing, because it also gives you an opportunity to be able to respond in an open and transparent way. You know, for this is why you need that senior level engagement to be able to do that. So, I mean, It's a hard question to answer because it's kind of a hypothetical one, and it's one that I haven't seen before. I think most people, you know, it's got your name, it's got your badge, so people aren't going to be on purpose harassing, and if they are, then that's a separate issue altogether. But
you can't just throw this in the company without having supporting policies of like harassment and
Well, it should most, you know, you can actually set up a usage policy, so when you start up Yammer, it'll pop up and you have to accept those rules. The best one I saw of them at a customer locally was it was just one line that said, don't do anything that would make us have a usage policy. So that was quite cool. But most of them just refer to the existing HR policy, something like you wouldn't do it in an email, you wouldn't do it in IM. And if you do it on here, your name's attached to it. It's the same as any other sort of process. If you've got an existing social media policy, it should be the same thing. Exactly, and that's where the whole kind of like behavioral thing comes in. Like it's a big issue, and Yammer will just amplify what your company already does. So it's an interesting problem.
Can I just add to that? As where like government, you could have this, and your employers could be using this without you knowing now. So you know they're free to put it up there and type your email address. So they might actually be using it in some of your organisations, and you don't know about it yet. So you know from a policy point of view.
Yeah.
But we have a code of conduct for employees, and we haven't created any special policies per se. Our code of conduct's quite broad enough to cover appropriate behaviour and
yep.
so forth. There's only documentation and stuff in speak as well, which is just sort of separate thing.
Yep.
You might have it, you might not.
So a great example locally is NAB. So they're a bank, and they've obviously got a lot of rules and regulations and stuff they can post on there and stuff they can't post on there. They've been using Yammer for... paid version of Yammer for almost four, nearly 5 years. They're one of the original guys, nearly 5 years now. And they have their admins have never had to delete a message from their network. The community manages itself, which I think is where you want to get to. And I think I've never actually seen an example where an employee's gone rogue on Yammer, or at least lived to tell the tale about it. But...
So you can also set up key search words, can't you?
So yeah, as part of...
Yep. Perfect.
Yep.
You can actually, it raises flags.
Yeah, you can do keyword monitoring. That's all part of the admin stuff, yeah.
So that controls a lot of that issue of bullying.
Exactly, yeah.
Just another quick governance question around files. I mean, we've been starting within our organisation to toy with Yammer. I've sort of got my foot squashed on it until we look and understand what we can do with the page.
Yep.
Because you showed uploading a file. And I had a heart attack if our file started getting stored in Yammer out of the cloud. So is there a way, for instance, when we go to the payment version, you know, you still want to discuss the documents and whatever, and that's one of our big drivers, is mm-hmm. the ability to discuss documents. And so internally, I've got guys pushing towards NewsGator because of that very thing.
Yep.
So it's quite interesting to see that you now got the plugin to it, and it didn't even know that app existed. But can you restrict the ability to prevent being able to upload files to Yammer and instead make sure that SharePoint remains the
No, there's not a technical way to block it as such. But again, NAB's a perfect example where they're covered by all these legislation where you can't upload certain types of files offshore. And so they built that into their policy on how to use Yammer. And everyone is aware of that when they sign up. They know what they can and can't do. So they upload their files to SharePoint and they have the integration and then they have that conversation around it. So there's a certain level of trust that you have to give your employees to this kind of stuff. And there will be mistakes, but again, if you get that community right and the engagement right, the community will manage itself. And if they see something that's not meant to be up there, 9 times out of 10, they'll pull it out themselves or alert an administrator saying, can you fix this up for me? Yeah. But technically, there's not a way to do that, no.
Just a question. In the Yammer mature organization, are they seeing niche for email still?
Honestly? No. Well,
it depends who's your audience. Like, you know, I get a lot of emails from customers. And they're not all on external networks, and they're not on Link, or they're not on Skype. You know, so there still might be those one-off cases where it's still very valid. Now that's one way to communicate in addition to phone and voicemail and face-to-face meeting. So that's typically one use case.
Yeah, and that's exactly
outside
how
of
we
organization,
use it.
Typically is the
yeah that use case. And right now meeting invites and calendars we do through email because there's no other way to do that.
Yeah,
but yeah. Within the Yammer organization in Microsoft, that's definitely the case. Since we got brought into Microsoft, there is more email, but we're trying to get Microsoft more Yammer, and it's we're getting closer.
But, plus to add to that, and then I'll wrap up to make sure we got a couple slides. But the idea, remember initially I mentioned our approach, it should be seamless. Meaning if Christoph been using email for many years and he's got all his rules and his colors and his day and his task management is driven by his Outlook, then fine. Like, we don't want to rock his world, but yet he should be social and participate in conversations. So we're definitely looking at doing tighter integration. Like Angus said, you can already go pretty far with notifications on helping Christoph to crawl, walk, run. So you don't rock my boat and suddenly, you know, I'm completely turned off. So this is something we're definitely working on. Actually, some of the initiatives is trying to help people graduate without saying it's black and white. Stop using email and go Yammer. We fully realize that's not acceptable from a change management perspective. So let's hold off on the question. We'll be around. Let me just cover a couple slides before you all leave. As we mentioned, we got tons of assets. Where you want to stay up to date on the roadmap or announcements, and you get the blogs and the Twitters. Customer Success Center, Angus talked about it. You want to learn about pricing. Typically, the question we get is, you know, what's the difference between basic and enterprise? And like Angus said, basic, you get the full functionality. Everything a Power would use, or a Novus. And enterprise is really for IT. That's when if you want to do Active Directory Sync or single sign-on, so Christoph doesn't have to re-enter his credentials. And more importantly, if Christoph is a student, and when he, you know, he does an internship, and when he goes back to uni, he's removed from AD, he's removed from Yammer, and you know, he doesn't have access to information he shouldn't have access to. So that's what Enterprise gives you, and there's a link that gives you side-by-side comparison. Link to Enterprise IT, all those advanced, you know, a lady in front was mentioning, yes, we have keyword monitoring, so if Christoph uses some bad, non-approved words, he can be kindly, the admin can be notified, and Christoph can be reminding in whatever shape or form of how to behave. Yammer Developer Center, again, you know, this, I know this is a technical audience, and remember we talk about, you know, one of the key pillars to be successful is to integrate. You want to integrate Yammer with one of those line of business apps that I mentioned, there's plenty of content, think of SDK, you're probably used to in the Microsoft world, so there's a lot of assets there. There's also a vibrant community where you can ask questions on OAuth and da-da-da-da-da. So it's pretty straightforward to integrate Yammer. And then the SharePoint integration, I kind of summarize all the links. The bottom line is, again, it's a story that's going to be evolving very fast. So do not wait for a year to see another session on Yammer. Definitely make sure you bookmark it on check the latest and greatest once in a while. I'm not going to have time to play this video, but when you get the deck, click on the CEO's face. And I think what's interesting about this video is, you know, you're not going to hear about a CIO talking about value. This is the CEO. When Adam talked about that new burger that they launched and how he reached out to those to those deskless workers that I was mentioning earlier, it's him in his own word. He's talking about real ROI. How much, you know, money did it save by tapping to the entire pool of waiters and waitresses to ship a new recipe and continue to be a leader in that segment of a burger chain in the US. So again, I think it's very insightful. Thing to maybe show to your peers if you get, you know, we'll have naysayers at each organization that are still not bought into the value. So to summarize, you know, I talk about the journey and what's unique about our approach. I showed you different scenarios to enable social, and you know, we've talked about social intranet, social productivity, and social business process. I give you a little glimpse of some of the dotted lines in terms of integration between SharePoint, Office 365, and Yammer. Angus talked about how to use Yammer, and more importantly, how to go about that journey that, you know, it's going to be iterative and it's not going to happen overnight. So a couple next steps. For those of you that haven't signed up, again, like we said, it's free. You know, kick the tires, try it out. Like we say, we got a lot of assets to help you get started, crawl, walk, run, to go about this social journey. And then, you know, if you want to find other customers, whether it's in Australia or elsewhere, whether it's in your industry, or whether it's a different department, you know, there's a lot of great stories out there on this site, typically video case studies, so it's very easy to listen. But guess what, there's gonna be a lot more coming. So again, like this is gonna be a lively set of assets, and look at it and then pass this around to the different stakeholders at your organizations. So with that, thank you very much for attending this session. Fill in your eval, we'll be around, and enjoy TechEd.
Good.